We will never forget that spring day in Colorado, exactly 20 years ago, when the unimaginable happened inside this suburban school. A turning point that foretold so many tragedies yet to come. Columbine changed our lives forever. But from devastation came determination. Tonight, how the students, faculty, and law enforcement officers inside this building on that day have spent the last two decades turning heartbreak into hope.
Hello and thanks for joining us. I'm Jeremy Hubbard here at Clement Park in Littleton, right behind Columbine High School. This is the memorial to the 12 students and one teacher killed exactly 20 years ago today at Columbine. For many of us, it seems like yesterday, and for so many, the wounds still haven't healed. With that in mind, we knew exactly what we wanted to do over the next half hour: honor the victims of the Columbine massacre. We also knew what we didn't want to do. We're not going to show the names or the faces of the killers. We're not going to play the 911 calls or show any of the images from April 20th, 1999. The families have endured two decades of that. Seems like enough. So instead, we're going to focus on some of the good that came from something very bad. Those of us who didn't know them still remember them so well from those yearbook photos, full of life, youthful, innocent, like every teenager we know, their brave teacher by their side.
Here's the map, looking fine.
But to their families, they were the world, like 16-year-old Matt Kechter. Easy kid, calm under pressure, loved to laugh. Sports were his life. Seventeen-year-old Rachel Scott was the middle child who loved to laugh, loved to play jokes, loved to write poetry and take pictures. 16-year-old Kelly Fleming woke up with joy in her heart every day. Her family says she was the happiest little kid who skipped and danced her way through life. Danny Rohrbaugh was a helper, whether it was helping on the family farm in western Kansas or helping in the family business after school. He always just wanted to help. 18-year-old Isaiah Scholes was a jokester, always had his family in stitches. He loved to tickle and tease his aunt. Corey DePooter wanted to be a Marine. He loved the outdoors and had a knack for knowing when something was wrong with someone. He went out of his way to make sure others didn't feel uncomfortable.
There's Daniel getting ready for his trip to France.
Daniel Mauser was quiet and shy, ran cross country, was on the debate team. He was just back from a two-week trip to Paris with the French club when he died. Cassie Bernal was a role model to her brother. She always smiled. You could expect a big hug and a warm welcome every time you saw her. From the time he was a toddler, John Tomlin loved cars. Car was one of his first words. His mom called him her knight in shining armor. He always went above and beyond. He planned to join the Army just after graduation from Columbine. Kyle Velasquez had been the perfect baby, but his parents knew there was something different about him. Turns out he'd had a stroke at birth, but years of speech therapy had paid off, and he was really enjoying his new school. He'd only been at Columbine 3 months when the massacre happened. Dave Sanders' daughters like to joke that he taught at Columbine for 25 years so he could coach there. His loves were the girls' basketball and softball teams. When the gunfire started that day, Mr. Sanders ran to the cafeteria and ushered dozens of students out of harm's way. He saved untold lives and was trying to save even more when he was shot from behind in an upstairs hallway. And Lauren Townsend was the straight-A student. Never got a B, never missed a day of school, never caused any trouble.
I just remember one time when she was asking me to help her with her math homework. I think she was a junior at the time, and I was trying to help her with it and realized she was asking me these questions. She was just trying to make me feel better, that I contribute somehow, because She had all the answers. And there was a time she came over and she wanted to use our computer. She had a big paper due the next day and she hadn't started on it till that morning. And I said, I gave her the whole lecture on procrastination. She came back and said, you were right, Dad, I made an A minus. Yes.
We recently had the chance to sit down with Lauren's family and nearly all the Columbine families inside the high school. Gone is the old library where 10 of the students were killed. We gathered in the new library.
I didn't expect 20 years later to be experiencing more of these mass shootings.
Where families talked about the heartbreaking loss they suffered and so many others have suffered in the years since.
We have people who understand what we're going through, and that's made a world of difference for us.
But they also talked about the hope that has sprung up in the last 20 years and the memories of their final weeks together. Memories etched in stone at the Columbine Memorial, like these words from Lauren Townsend, a vivid description of what heaven would look like. Seems heaven was on Lauren's mind in the weeks before she died.
Sometime between Christmas and April 20th, she had written about a 4 or 5 page will. And the will basically said, I feel like something's going to happen. You just never know. So I think I need to write these thoughts down. This is what I want to see when I get to heaven. This is who I want to meet. These are questions I'm going to ask. They were burning questions. And she said, you know, when I leave, I don't want you to mourn, because if you mourn, you can mourn for a little bit, but then I want you to start laughing and be happy, because if you mourn, I'm going to come back and haunt you. So reading her diary was kind of like, I feel like I'm breaking her privacy, but at the same time, you just want to just suck up every piece of her. I want to know everything. I don't want to leave anything unturned.
Maybe it's just coincidence, but it turns out Lauren Townsend wasn't alone in her thoughts among Columbine victims leading up to the tragedy.
And I know Dawn, and talking with other moms and other families, had gotten some of the same feelings from their kids, where they kind of had this feeling that something huge was going to happen. And they were proud to be part of making a difference.
Just ask Rachel Scott's father.
Honestly, a couple of years before the tragedy, I told my wife, I feel like something is coming. And I feel like there's something that we're supposed to be doing. And of course, I would have never wanted to know what it was or wanted it to be that. But I do believe sometimes we have premonitions, as Rachel did in a lot of her writings, of things yet to come.
Just passing by, not staying long. Those are Rachel's own words etched on her memorial, along with the words she spoke to a teacher on the very day she died. I'm going to have an impact on the world, she said. She has. They all have. And hopefully their own words will have a lasting impact too.
I am at peace with where Lauren is. I just am not at peace with how she got there. And that's what we need to keep fighting, is stop this madness.
I realized at that moment, the only person I had to rely on was myself.
There are victims.
I was shot twice in the head and once in the foot.
And there are victors. Given how far Patrick Ireland has come in 20 years, there's no doubt which one he is.
My head came above that library table just an inch or two. Buckshot from the sawed-off shotgun penetrated my skull, traveling through the left hemisphere of my brain, paralyzing me on my right side and impacting my ability to see clearly. No mobility on my right side.
Ireland was in the library when the gunman walked in and started shooting, killing 10 students. Somehow he survived. Barely able to move, he had to figure out how to get out of the school.
So I rolled over on my back and began to push myself with my one good leg for the arduous journey to the nearest exit.
That nearest exit just happened to be a shot-out second-story window.
It took nearly 3 hours to crawl the nearly 50 feet from where I was shot to that window. I finally built up enough strength necessary to hoist myself, push myself up the window, flip over, and start sweeping away excess pieces of jagged glass.
Just then, in a fog, he heard voices. It was the SWAT team in an armored vehicle pulling up just in time to help.
I began to make my move. I was out of there. I didn't wait for them to give me the okay. Almost too soon, my lifeless body plunged under the top of that Loomis Fargo truck.
Patrick Ireland, the boy in the window, became the most iconic reminder of what happened at Columbine and the personification of a mass shooting victim. But that victim part didn't set well with this determined young man, who spent the next few months at Craig Hospital learning to walk again. And soon, he was right back at Columbine.
I was able to graduate on time with my class of 2000, as well as achieving my goal of graduating valedictorian. 20 years later, I'm 37 now. I've got three kiddos, 8, 4, and 9 months old. And so got some conversations with the oldest, with our oldest daughter. And, you know, because she's asked questions before, you know, Daddy, what happened? Why do you wear that brace? Why do you walk with a limp? You know, we've had some of those conversations. Our journey was not easy. We owe a debt of gratitude to first responders, police officers, SWAT, doctors, nurses, therapists, through the help of that entire recovery process.
These days, you'd never know what Patrick went through all those years ago, if not for the presentations he gives, sharing his story. Like this one, at the National Summit on School Safety in Houston just weeks ago, where he reminds people.
We have a choice of being a victor or a victim.
And proves with every word which choice he made 20 years ago.
The key to forgiveness is to stop focusing on what others have done to us and focus on what has been done for us.
Sometimes you have to get far away to get close to someone.
Where I try to really honor his memory and be closest to him is when I'm fly fishing. That's something that we shared together, and it's still something that I do alone most often these days. And when I'm out there and I catch a fish that's of above average size, I'll kind of give him a nod and say, you know, he was with me today.
Austin Eubanks can still feel the presence of his teenage best friend, Corey DePooter, who died right next to him under a library table 20 years ago at Columbine High School.
I was just playing dead. There was really nothing that any of us could have done at that point, especially not knowing what was even happening. And so both of the perpetrators fired multiple shots under our table, and I was hit twice, and Corey was killed instantly.
What Austin couldn't have known at age 17 was the very medicine given to him that day to numb his physical pain would be the cause of so much emotional anguish still to come.
Of everybody who was actually shot, I was the least severe. I wasn't internally injured. I wasn't critically injured. In retrospect, I probably needed some form of pain management, narcotic pain management, for 3 to 5 days. When I left the hospital, I had a 30-day supply of medication. I went back to my primary care physician just a few days later, and I got another 30-day supply of medication. Without any understanding that I was going to have an increased susceptibility to developing a habit, because I was inadvertently going to be treating those underlying emotional symptoms with the medications that were prescribed for my physical pain.
What followed was more than a decade of addiction. Oxycontin, Adderall, illicit drugs, booze, rehab, and relapse became his life.
So when people ask me what my drug of choice was, I tell them, well, it was opiates that really fueled my addiction, but my drug of choice was really just more. I wanted more of whatever you had, and there was never enough.
About 8 years ago, he realized he had to make a change.
When I finally decided to do whatever it took to recover, I knew that it meant changing everything about my life. And so I walked away from a career in advertising. I went back to school to study addiction. I finally got my foot in the door working part-time for a treatment center, and I worked my way up in this field. And so I went down and I took all of the negative influences out of my life, and I replaced them with people, places, and things that held me accountable for being the best version of myself. I had no idea of what these medications were even supposed to do.
These days, the best version of himself
I had to go through the stages of grief that I should have been going through at age 17, at age 29.
He's sharing his story of addiction, recovery, and the dangers of substance abuse with whomever will listen.
I very quickly began drug seeking in order to soothe my emotional pain.
The hope is to warn others how opiates are overprescribed and how they'll only make the emotional pain worse.
For many years, especially in the core of my addiction, I wasn't living my life in a way that was honorable to Corey's memory at all.
Medicine comes in all forms. Austin prefers this kind these days, getting far away so he can get close to someone who meant the world to him.
It was the emotional pain of losing a best friend, and especially in that fashion, watching him be murdered. And so for me, a passion that Corey and I both had was fly fishing. That's something we shared together. And I lost that throughout my addiction. And it's been something, fortunately, I've been able to come back to in my recovery, where I feel especially close to him.
Spend enough time on a football field and you'll hear someone say it. Football is just a game. And it's true, but every once in a blue moon, a game becomes something more.
It's so much bigger than a football game. It's so much bigger than a football team.
Sometimes sports can heal.
Retrospectively looking back, I had instant baggage.
It happened here in the days and weeks following what was our nation's deadliest school shooting 20 years ago.
People have heard about Columbine football. They've heard about Columbine High School. This is the untold story of Columbine football.
We are 16, 17-year-old kids. We were no different than anybody else.
That story now being made into a documentary told by those who lived it.
That group of kids were so special. They were so tight.
What football did for us is it gave us a break.
Ryan Barrett was hiding in the back room of the school library that fateful day in April of 99 when two gunmen stormed in and murdered his best friend, Matt Kechter.
I know when I got out of the school, I stopped and I was looking for him. He never came, obviously.
Heavy stuff, especially for a 16-year-old. Fortunately, Barrett found an escape in football.
Living that day to day for me was, well, where's the exits? How do I get out of here? Well, you didn't feel that on a football field. That went away. On a football field, football's football.
David Jones, the fullback, running room, the 10, the 5, and Columbine has
Columbine football team strung together 13 wins the season after the massacre. One win, they say, for each victim killed in the shootings.
If we would have went out and lost every game, everyone would have said, you know what, that's okay. You guys dealt with something that no one can imagine. So it's okay. You guys, you just went out there and did it. But that's not Columbine football.
We had heart. There's no doubt. We had heart. And we had a mindset.
Looney looking, lobs it, open, Conant, touchdown.
And as the players adopted that mindset, so too did the Columbine community.
People who never thought of going to a football game were showing up at games because it meant something more, something that we could all experience together. And it was something positive. And we were all refusing to let evil win.
And evil was defeated. The team marched all the way to the state championship, defeating Cherry Creek by a score of 21-14.
This is our trophy. It has all of our guys, our team that was on it.
The team chanted Matt Kechter's initials.
I've never been more proud of to be part of something in my life.
As they celebrated in the locker room afterward with his family.
I don't think you ever get to the title game without Matt.
It's a moment when football became so much more than just a game. It helped heal a community, proving in the end, good will prevail.
Yes, we persevered. Yes, and it was just a football season, but we did something kind of special.
And that's the Columbine these men choose to remember, the year that love conquered all.
Love heals all and love rules all. And I think this instance, love was accompanied with a state championship trophy that was shaped like a football.
Hard to imagine ever having to try and save school children from a shooter.
One school shooting is enough for any law enforcement officer's career. You've had three.
I've had three.
For Deputy Chief DeAndrea, the violence at Columbine was just the beginning.
7 years later, he's on the SWAT team that confronts the gunman who killed 16-year-old student Emily Keyes at Platte Canyon High School near Bailey. He's just feet away from her when she dies.
Well, I don't know if you can see, but I got a picture of Emily right here on my wall. Reminds me every day about what this job is, the ramifications of this job, and what our obligation is back to this community. Every day when I walk in here, I see that. I still wear this bracelet.
What's it say?
It says, I love you guys. 9/27/2006, Emily Keyes.
Those words are the final text message Emily sends to her dad before she dies. Almost a year later, it happens again. The Youth with a Mission missionary school shooting in Arvada. He's the fourth officer inside the building where they find four gunshot victims, including Philip Krause and Tiffany Johnson.
There on the ground was Tiffany. And she was unconscious, but she was breathing. She'd been shot 11 times.
He helps carry them both out of the building before they die at the hospital. But they had every victim out of this building within 10 minutes of the first 911 call. Proof of the skills they learned after Columbine, like quick responses, no longer waiting for SWAT officers, but teaching patrolmen how to get inside a school right away if there's a gunman. And from the Platte Canyon shooting came something called the Standard Response Protocol, training that's now in place in 22,000 schools across the U.S. and Canada, even in preschools, colleges, businesses, getting police and educators on the same page, using the same language, creating lockdown and lockout procedures that keep people alive.
I truly believe that lessons learned from Columbine helped save lives that day.
And even his day-to-day conversations since Columbine may have helped save at least one precious life.
You can imagine, dinner at my home was, and still to this day, right, is a little bit different. We talk about these things. We talk about, you know, life-saving strategies. What do? It is incumbent upon me as a father, not just a cop, but as a father, to talk to my daughters about, if this happens, what are we gonna do?
So when your daughter was in a bar in Thousand Oaks, California last year.
Yeah, so.
She knew what to do.
Right.
As if three school shootings aren't enough, his daughter is inside this bar and grill back in November when a gunman walks in and kills 12 people.
I get a text from my daughter that says, I love you guys.
Just like Emily Keyes.
Just like Emily Keyes.
You can imagine the panic going through this father's mind. But because of all those post-Columbine conversations.
She knew exactly what to do. So she looks around the kitchen, and she actually saw a lady climbing into the attic. There was a ladder on the wall. She sees this gal going up there, and so she climbs up there, and some more people followed her.
After an hour and a half, SWAT team members rescue her and the others barricaded inside. Just as A.J. DeAndrea did at the Columbine shooting 20 years earlier, his first of too many such rescues.
You've been through three school shootings. In the back of your head, do you fear there will be a fourth?
I believe that there will be a fourth.
As heartbreaking as it is that 12 children died at Columbine, the children of teacher Dave Sanders can at least take comfort in knowing there would be far more memorial crosses if not for their dad's bravery that day.
You know, the word hero is thrown around a lot, but it really applies to your dad.
Very much so.
When you think about him going into that cafeteria and getting all those kids out of there, what a legacy, right?
Yeah, he, you know, somebody had said he was an adult, and that's different than losing a child. And it is, very much so. But my goodness, he saved so many kids. There were only 12. We don't have to read more names because of what he did. He did that. He made that choice. And for a long time as his family, we were upset with him because we felt like he chose everybody but us, because he didn't have to run into the school. He didn't have to run at the shooters, but he did. And then he waited for all of the kids to get out of the room before he died. And now I run into people that had him as a teacher, and one of them said, can I take a picture of you holding my child? And I said, why? And they said, because they wouldn't be here without your dad. And so it's like we're seeing these generations of kids that had a chance to grow up to be adults and parents and grandparents.
Because of your dad.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
It is cool. My sisters and I are so proud.
Dave Sanders touched thousands of lives in his 25 years as a business teacher at Columbine. So why don't more people remember the names of the victims, like Coach Sanders, than they do the names of the killers?
The more that we focused on them, the bigger that following became.
It is a question Connie Sanders has pondered for two decades, which is why she believes in no notoriety for mass shooters. Maybe if we don't publicize the killers, there'll be less killing.
And boy, the research is strong that if we just stop making this a competition of the deadliest, the worst, who did it, what their motivation was, it's a fascination that has taken on a life of its own, and we want to make sure that that doesn't continue.
Let's remember these amazing lives, Connie says, and not those who tragically ended them. For many families today, the 20th anniversary of the shooting was spent here at Clement Park at the memorial dedicated to the 12 kids they loved and the hero teacher who died saving lives. But as each anniversary has passed, each family has developed its own traditions on how to spend April 20th. It is not a day Tom Mauser, who lost his son Daniel, looks forward to.
We go to his graveside, put new flowers in, and then just wait for the day to pass. It's a terrible day.
As they always do, today the school district opened Columbine's doors to the families of those killed here, where the former principal reads the names of the victims and families get time to themselves. It's where you could find the family of Rachel Joy Scott, the very first student killed in the Columbine attack.
We have a little ritual. We leave a rose at the spot where she was killed, go to her grave, and so it's very private.
There's a special spot inside Columbine where the family of teacher Dave Sanders always spends part of the anniversary. This spot in the hallway where they inlaid a giant Columbine flower on the school's floor, the exact spot where Sanders was shot.
Last year, I came and on the flower, there were 15 kids painting posters for something amazing. And I thought, this is perfect. That's Dad's flower. And all of these kids are sitting there having a great time doing a community service project, and it was at that point that I thought, Columbine's doing the right thing.
Doing the right thing is something the Columbine families have attempted to do every day for the last 20 years. And for many of them, that has meant forgiving.
And it's very important to choose to forgive. Forgiveness is an issue of your own heart. And if so, the option is either to forgive or not to, and if you don't, you're going to be bitter, angry, looking for revenge. It can ruin your life. Your child wouldn't want that, and you shouldn't want that.
Hard to believe it. In fact, the kids who are students at Columbine today weren't even alive when the tragedy happened. And many of those who were here that day are now parents themselves. Parents worry about their own children because of what they endured here in Littleton 20 years ago today. I'm Jeremy Hubbard. We thank you so much for joining us tonight. We leave you with a tribute to the 12 students and one teacher we honor on this Columbine 20th anniversary Day of Remembrance.